ओम ज्ञानतिमिरन्नस्य ज्ञानञ्जनाशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः.
And we'll start off tonight by chanting chapters 7, 8, and 9 from the Gita. As we mentioned on the first of the year, one of the basic practices of Krishna consciousness is to recite the Vedic scriptures, especially Bhagavad Gita, daily basis is best, and the more the better. I just had a nice communication with Pradyumna Prabhu today. He was Prabhupada's Sanskrit editor, and also traveled with Prabhupada all over the world while he was producing all his books. Actually, he was the first one in ISKCON to learn Sanskrit. Very scholarly person and a wonderful devotee. And in one of his letters to me today, email, he was saying how he had taken the manuscript of Shirsha Upanishad and was chanting the verses. And Prabhupada liked it very much, and he said, teach everybody else to chant these verses every day. So I know when I first came to the San Francisco temple, that Jayananda Prabhu was reciting the Shirsha Upanishad every day. So I'd sit down with him and recite these verses. And he said that when Prabhupada realized that Pradyumna had learned Sanskrit, was in the process of learning it and was able to pronounce the Sanskrit, Pradyumna said that he was the first one in ISKCON who was actually able to pronounce Sanskrit properly. And Prabhupada was very excited about it, and he said to teach all the others how to do that. And also, that's when he introduced the daily Bhagavatam classes where the devotees would go through the Sanskrit verses very carefully. So there is... Prabhupada did give an emphasis. Obviously, he wanted his books with the Sanskrit in them for authenticity as well. And there is an important aspect to the practice of Krishna consciousness, hearing these original verses and learning them and so forth. So let's look at these three chapters. Atha Saptamo Adhyayaha, beginning with chapter 7. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha Maya Sakta Mana Partha Yogam Yunjan Madashrayaha Asamshayam Samagramam Yata Gyasyasi Tachchinu Jnanam Teham Savignanam Idam Bhakshyam Yasheshataha Yaj Gyatva Nehabuyo Nyaj Gatavyam Avashishyate Manushyanam sahasreshu kashchid yatati siddhaye yatatam api siddhanam kashchin mam veti tatvataha humir apo nalo vayu kamano bhutir evacha ahankara iti yame binna prakriti rashtada apareyam itastvanyam Prakritim vidime param, jiva bhutam mahabaho, yayedam daryate jagat, itadyonini bhutani, sarvanityupadaraya, aham kritsnasya jagata, pravava pralayastata, matak paratanam nanyat, kinchidasti dananjaya, Mai sarvam idam protam sutre manigana iva rasoham apsukaunteya prabhasmi shashishuryayoho pranavak sarva vedeshu shabdake purusham drashu punyokanda prativyamcha tejas chasmi vibhavasau jivanam sarva bhuteshu Tapas chasmi tapas vishu bijamam sarva bhutanam vidiparta sanatanam Buddhir buddhiman tamasmi, tejas tejas vinamaham, balam balamatam chaham, kamaraga vivarjitam, dharma vidodho bhuteshu, kamosmi paratarshabha, echaiva satvika bhava, rajasastamashaschaye, mata iveti tanvidhi, natvaham teshu che mayi. Tribir gunamayer bhaver, ebe sarvam idam jagat, mohitam nabi janati, mamebhya paramavyayam. Daiva hi esha gunamayi, mama maya duratyaya, mameva ye prapadyante, maya metam tarantite. Namam duskritino mudha, prapadyante naradama, mayaya prittagyana, asuram bhavamashritaha. Chaturvida bachante mam, jana sukritino arjuna, arto jignasur artarti, jnani cha bharatarshabha. Tisham jnani nitya yukta, eka bhaktir vishishyate, priyohi jnani no tyartam, aham sacha mama priyaha. Udara saiva evaite, jnani tvat maiva me matam, astita sahi yuktatma, mamevanutamam gatim. Bahunam jamanamante, jnanavan mam prapadyate, Vasudeva sarvamiti, sa mahatma sadurlabaha. Kamaistaiste thritagyana, prapadyante nyadevataha, tam tam niyamamastaya, prakritya niyatasvaya. Yo yo yam yam tanum pakta, shadayar chitum ichyati, tasya tasya chalam shradham, tameva vidadham yaham. Sataya shadaya yuktas, tasya ardhanam ihate, labate chatata kaman, mayaiva vihitan hitan. Antavatu palam tesham, tadbhavat yalpamedasam, devan deva yajo yanti, madbhakta yanti mamapi. Avyaktam vyaktam apannam, manyante mamabhudhayaha, parambhavam ajananto, mamavyayam anutamam. Naham prakashya sarvasya, yogamaya samavritaha, mudoyam nabijanati, loko mamajam avyayam. Vedaham samatitani, vartamanani charjuna, bhavishyani cha bhutani, mamtu veda nakashana. Icha dvesha samutena, dvanva mohena parata, sarva bhutani sammoham, sargayante parantapa. Yesham tvantagatam papam, jananam punyakarmanam, te dvandva mohanir mukta, bhajante mam dridavrataha. Jara manana mokshaya, mama shritya yatantiye, te brahma tadvidu kritsnam, adhyatmam karma chakilam. Sari bhutari daivam mam, sari yagyam chaye viduhu, prayana kali pichamam, devadur yukta chetasaha. Om tat sariti srimad bhagavad gita supanishatsu ramavidyayam yoga shastre shri krishna arjuna sambade vigana yoga nama saptamo jayaha. Taraka brahma yoga ata ashtamo jayaha. Arjunuvacha, kim tad brahma kim adhyatmam, kim karma purushottama, hari bhutam cha kim proktam, hari daivam kim uchate, hari yagya katam kotra, dehesmin madasudana, prayana kali chakatam, geyosi niyatatma bihi. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha, Aksharam Brahma Paramam, Sabhavo Dhyatma Muchate, Bhuta Bhavod Bhavakaro, Visarga Karma Samjitaha, Hari Bhutam Sharo Bhava, Purushaschari Daivatam, Hari Yagyohami Vatra, Dehe Deha Vratambara, Antakale chamameva smaran muktva kalevaram yaprayati samadbhavam yati nasyastra samshayaha yang yang vapi smaran bhavam tajatyante kalevaram tam tame vaite kaunteya sadatad bhava bhavitaha tasmat sarveshu kaleshu Mamanu smara yudhyacha, mayarpita mano budhir, mami vaishyasya samshayaha, abhyasa yoga yuktena, chetasa nanya gamina, paramam purusham divyam, yati partanu chintayam, gavim burana manushashitaram, Anuraniyam samanusmeredyaha sarvasya dataram achintya rupam aditya varnam tamasa parastat paryana kale manasa chalena bhaktya yukto yoga balena chaiva ruvor madhye pranam avesya samyak satam param purusham upaiti divyam Yadaksharam veda vido vadanti vashanti yadyata yovita ragaha yadishanto brahmacharyam charanti tate padam sangrahena pravakshe sarvadvarani samyamya manuhridi narudyacha murdyadhayatmana pranam astito yogadharanam Om ite kaksharam brahma vyaharan mamanusmaram yaprayati tajandeham sayati paramam gatim ananya cheta satatam yomam smarati nityashaha tasyaham sulabha partha nitya yuktasya yoginaha Mamupetya punarjanma dukalayam ashashvatam napnuvanti mahatmana samsidhim paramam gataha abhrama bhuvana loka punaravartinarjuna mamupetya tu kaunteya punarjanma navidyate sahasra yuga paryantam Arhadya brahmano viduhu ratrim yuga sahasrantam teho ratra vido janaha avyakta vyaktaya sarva prabhavatya haragame rakyagame praliyante tatraiva vyaktya samjake bhuta grama sa evayam bhutva bhutva praliyate Pratyagame vashaparta prabhavatya haragame parastasmatu bhavo nyom vyakto vyaktat sanatanaha yaksak sarveshu bhuteshu nasyatsuna vinashyati avyakto shara ityuktas tamahu paramam gatim yam prapya nanivartante Tadhama paramam mama purusha sa para partha
Bhaktya labhyas tvananyaya yasyantastani bhutani yena sarva midam tatam yatra kale tunavritim avritim chaiva yoginaha priyata yanti tam kalam vakshami bharatarshava agnir jyotir ahashukla shanmasa utarayanam tatra prayata gacchanti brahma brahma vido janaha tumo ratris tata krishna shanmasa dakshanayanam tatra chandramasam jyotir yogi prapya nivartate shukla krishne gatiyete jagata shashvate mate ekaya yatyanavritim anyaya vartate punaha naite sriti parta janan yogi muyati kashana tasmat sarveshu kaleshu yoga yukto bhavarjuna vedeshu yagneshu tapasu chaiva daneshu yat punya palam pratishtam adyeti tat sarvam idam vaditva yogi param stanam upaiti chadyam. Om tat sat iti srimad bhagavad gita supanishatsu brahma vidyayam yoga shastre shri krishna arjuna sambhade taraka brahma yoga nama ashtamo jayah.
Chapter 9, The Most Confidential Knowledge. Raja Kuya Yoga. Atta Navamod Adhyayaha.
Shri Bhagavanuvacha. Idam tu te kuyatamam. Pravaksham yana suyave. Jnanam vijnana sahitam. Yajgyatva mokshyase shubhad. Raja Vidya Raja Kuyam. Pavitram idam uttamam pratyakshavagamam dharmyam susukam kartum avyayam ashadadhana purusha dharmasyasya parantapa aprapyamam nivartante mrityu samsara spartmani mayatatamidam sarvam jagadavyakta murtina Mastani sarva bhutani nachaham teshva vastitaha nacha mastani bhutani pashyame yogam aishvaram bhuta brinacha bhutasto mamatma bhuta bhavanaha yata kashastato nityam vayu sarvatra go mahan tata sarvani bhutani Matstani tu padaraya sarva bhutani kaunteya prakritim yanti mamikam kalpakshayi punastani kalpadau visrajamyaham prakritim swamavashtabhya visrajami punapunaha bhutagramam imam kritsnam avasham prakritir vishad Nacha mam tani karmani nibadnanti dananjaya udasina vadasinam asaktam teshu karmasu mayadyaksena prakritihi suyate sacharacharam hetunanena kaunteya jagad viparivartate avajananti mam buddha Manushim tandam ashritam param bhavam ajananto mama bhuta maheshwaram mogasha moga karmano moga jnana vichetasaha rakshasim asurim chaiva prakritim mohinim shritaha mahatmanastumam partha Daivim prakritim ashritaha vajantyananya manaso gyatva bhutadim avyayam satatam kirtayanto mam yatantascha dridhavrataha namasyantascha mandaktya nitya yukta upasate jnana yagnena chapyanye yajanto mam upasate ekatvena pratakvena bahuda vishvato mukam aham kratura aham yagna sodaham aham aushadam mantroham aham evajam aham agnir aham hutam pitaham asya jagato mata data pitamaha vejam pavitram omkara ruksama yajurevacha gatir bharta prabhu sakshi nivasa sharanam surit pravava pralayastanam nidhanam bijam avyayam tapamyaham aham varsham nigranami utsrajami cha amritam chaiva mrityuscha sarasaccha hamarjuna Traividyamam soma paputa papa jagner ishva swargatim prartayante te punyama sadya surrendra lokam ashnanti divyan divideva bogan te tam bhuktva swarga lokam vishalam shinye punye martya lokam vishanti evam trai dharmam anuprapanna gata gatam kama kama labhate ananyas chintayanto mam ye jana pariupasate tesham nityabdi yuktanam yoga kshemam baham yaham ye pyanya devata bhakta yajante shadayan vitaha tepi mameva kaunteya yajantya vidhi purvakam aham hi sarva jagnanam prokta cha prabhur eva cha natu mam abhijananti tafena tashchyavanti te yanti deva vrata devam pitrin yanti pratirvataha bhutan yanti bhuteja yanti madhyajino pimam patram pushpam palam toyam yome bhaktya prayachati taraham bhakti paritam ashnami pariyatatmanaha karoshi yad ashnasi yaj johosi dadasi yad yat tapasyasi kaunteya tat kurushva madarpanam Shubha shubha palerevam mokshyase karma bandana he sanyasa yoga yuktatma vimukto mam upaishyasi samoham sarvabhuteshu name dveshosti napriyaha ye bhajanti tumam bhaktya maite teshu chapyaham apichet sudaracharo Vajate mam ananya bhak sadureva samantavya samyag vyavasito hisaha shripram bhavati dharmatma shashvat shantim nigachati kaunteya pratijanihi name bhakta pranashyati mami partha vyapashritya yepi supapayonayaha Sriyo vaishyas tata shudras te piyanti param gatim kim punar brahmana punya bhakta rajar shayastata anditiyam asukham lokam imam prapya bhajasvamam manmana bhavamad bhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mami vaishyas yuktvaivam Atmarama parayanaha Om Tat Sariti Srimad Bhagavad Gita Supanishatsu Brahma Vidyayam Yoga Shastre Shri Krishna Arjuna Sambhare Raja Kuhya Yoga Nama Navamo Jayaha Hari Om.
Feel better? Yeah, we could take shelter of Bhagavad Gita. Krishna has given it for us to take shelter of. His words are absolute, so they're non-different from himself. Though this world is a dark place, when the sun goes down, we see how dark it is. The shining light of the sun, Krishna says, is himself in this world. In the Brahma Samhita, yach chakshuresha savita sakalagrahanam raja samasta suramutirashesha teja yasyagnaya brahmati samvritakala chakro govindamari purusham tamaham bhajami. The eye of the Lord. And when we're feeling that darkness, we can take shelter of Bhagavad Gita. So those who every day read the Bhagavad Gita, take time to read the chapters, become satisfied. This is the method for feeling actual satisfaction. But recite the verses and read the purports carefully, and then the intellect becomes fortified also. One who regularly recites, reads, hears from the Bhagavad Gita will become immune from the effects of Maya, the illusory energy that drags us into unsavory situations that leave us wanting or leave us entangled. So this is the process for actually advancing in spiritual life, is to spend time with Bhagavad Gita every day. This is the simple answer. Bhagavad Gita is the words of the Supreme Personality of God in Himself, and therefore, as is mentioned by Srila Rupa Goswami in the Laghu Bhagavatamrita, the Bhagavad Gita has particular potency. So everyone can take advantage of this, especially those who are devotees. There's full permission given in the Shastra to take time every day. You can chalk out as much time as you like to read Bhagavad Gita. That's perfectly fine. And even the CEOs and managers of Silicon Valley should be fine with that. Because this is a highly revered book, and it's Krishna's instruction to take time to hear from the Bhagavad Gita. That's why he spoke it. So these particular chapters, 7, 8, and 9, nice to learn those chapters altogether. We can sit around and chant as much as we like into the wee hours of the night. And that sometimes may seem like when I say that, I mean the prospect of picking up the Bhagavad Gita every day may seem difficult some days, or chanting Hare Krishna may seem difficult, because we are living in an atmosphere of dichotomy. And what is that? We have the dress which is made of matter. And Krishna describes in which verse, Gita Priya, in the Bhagavad Gita, that this body is a dress.
2:22.
Is that right?
Yes.
Confirm. And then give them the microphone, they'll chant the verse for you. It's in that blue book he's got in his lap. Is it 2:22? Everyone say 2:22.
2:22.
Okay, go ahead. Together, the two of you chant it.
Vasamsi jirnani yatha vihaya navani granati naroparani tatha sharirani vihaya jirnani Anyani samyati navani dehi.
Let's look at the translation. As a person puts on new garments, giving up old ones, the soul similarly accepts new material bodies, giving up the old and useless ones. What verse is this? 2.22. Here's the purport. Change of body by the atomic individual soul is an accepted fact. Even the modern scientists who do not believe in the existence of the soul, but at the same time cannot explain the source of energy from the heart, have to accept continuous changes of body, which appear from childhood to boyhood and from boyhood to youth, and again from youth to old age. From old age, the change is transferred to another body. This has already been explained in a previous verse, 2.13. Transference of the atomic individual soul to another body is made possible by the grace of the supersoul. The supersoul fulfills the desire of the atomic soul as one friend fulfills the desire of another. The Vedas, like the Mundaka Upanishad, as well as the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, compare the soul and the supersoul to two friendly birds sitting on the same tree. One of the birds, the individual atomic soul, is eating the fruit of the tree, and the other bird, Krishna, is simply watching his friend. Of these two birds, although they are the same in quality, one is captivated by the fruit. One is captivated by the fruits of the material tree, while the other is simply witnessing the activities of his friend. Krishna is the witnessing bird, and Arjuna is the eating bird. Although they are friends, one is still the master and the other is the servant. Forgetfulness of this relationship by the atomic soul is the cause of one's changing his position from one tree to another or from one body to another. The jiva soul is struggling very hard on the tree of the material body, but as soon as he agrees to accept the other bird as the supreme spiritual master, as Arjuna agreed to do by voluntary surrender, everyone say voluntary surrender. Unto Krishna for instruction, the subordinate bird immediately becomes free from all lamentations. Both the Mundaka Upanishad 3.1.2 and Shvetashvatara Upanishad 4.7 confirm this. Samani vrikshe purusho nimagno nishaya shochiti muhyamanaha jushtam yada pashyat yanyam isham asya Mahimanam iti vita shoka. Although the two birds are in the same tree, the eating bird is fully engrossed with anxiety and moroseness as the enjoyer of the fruits of the tree. But if in some way or another or other he turns his face to his friend, the Lord, and knows his glories, at once the suffering bird becomes free from all anxieties. Arjuna has now turned his face toward his eternal friend, Krishna, and is understanding the Bhagavad Gita from him. And thus, hearing from Krishna, he can understand the supreme glories of the Lord and be free from lamentation. Arjuna is advised herewith by the Lord not to lament for the bodily change of his old grandfather and his teacher. He should rather be happy to kill their bodies in the righteous fight so that they may be cleansed at once of all reactions from various bodily activities. One who lays down his life on the sacrificial altar or in the proper battlefield is at once cleansed of bodily reactions and promoted to a higher status of life. So there was no cause for Arjuna's lamentation. So it's confirmed and accepted, as Prabhupada mentions in the purport, that the body is a dress and it's changeable. In fact, sometimes it's described as a residence or like an apartment, of which we've gotten not a very good contract, actually. Because we can be kicked out at any time. Need to renegotiate the contract, because if you get an apartment and you can be evicted at any moment, you need a lawyer to work things out. In any case, that's one side of the dichotomy, that I have to care for the necessities of the body. And Prabhupada mentions in his purport, his introduction to the Bhagavad Gita, that the eternal soul is living in an atmosphere of non-permanence, impermanence, and that is that at any moment he feels that his existence could be terminated. So this creates a fearful
environment, fearful situation. Elsewhere in the introduction, he poetically says that we're being stalked by the tigress of Maya. And that's not a very peaceful situation when you're being stalked by anyone, what to speak of a tigress, when you can be caught around any corner by that tigress. So this is described as the side of life in which we have to care for our necessities, the necessity of the material body, and the entire atmosphere of the material world is surcharged with survival. Hastani sahastanam aparani chatushpadam palguni tatra mahatam jivo jivasya jivanam. You know that verse? Oh. Jivo jivasya jivanam means that the general rule holds that one living being is food for another. And those who have two hands, they feed on those who have no hands. Those who have legs feed on those who have no legs. I mean, just watch the Nature Channel for a while and you'll see there's a lot of feeding going on. One living being, jivo jivasya jivanam, for another. So the atmosphere of the material world is survival. One living being is surviving on another. You have to kill to live in this material world. And this creates a tension and anxiety. And furthermore, as we've discussed in previous classes, sociologists, psychologists have determined how there's a hierarchy of needs. Specifically, I'm referring to Maslow and his pyramid, which shows the hierarchy of needs. We cannot begin to consider our higher self, he postulates, that until we've taken care of some of the basic needs, to find shelter, to have food in our stomach and so forth, and then to have a sense of security and socially and so forth. At the very top there's of his pyramid is self-actualization. But he shows how there's a foundation for each one of the higher levels of understanding of life. And in our Varnashram system, which Krishna says is created by him, himself, and the Varnas and Ashrams, the idea is that coming into the world, one has a stable situation in which to work according to his or her own nature. And from that stable situation, one can then pursue higher thoughts in life and can think about self-actualization, can think about worshiping the Lord and so forth. So on one side, on the other side, we have the soul who is forever optimistic about doing anything. In fact, there are many songs you can look at and see. They're written in this mood of anything is possible. I was looking at one today. Unfortunately, I didn't print it out because I was elsewhere, away from my printer. Song, I think it's called like The Impossible, Dream the Impossible Dream. The lyrics go on and on expressing how the spirit of trying to go further, look beyond just the temporary world and find full potential in life. There are many songs like that, right? You have that in your notebook. Dream the impossible dream. And where does this come from? You have it? It says dream the impossible dream. All things are possible for the one who believes. There it is. You'll find it all around us. This is the soul peeking out from behind the temporary body and the atmosphere of struggle for existence. Who is that soul who is searching for that which is beyond our normal circumstances? For instance, trying to fly to other planets. Why spend so much time and money trying to go to the bottom of the ocean and go in every direction of the world? Because there's a way in which the soul waking up in material nature, especially in human life, realizes that I'm something more than just the material body, and I can do more than just struggle for existence. I can find something that's unlimited. There's that intuitive sense within the living entity.
And as Prabhupada's revered godbrother, Srila Sridhar Maharaj used to say, this Omkar, wouldn't you say, everyone say Om.
Om.
He said, that's the big yes. It means, yes, you can. Yes, you have unlimited potential. Try for it. The Shastras say that come out of the darkness. Tamasi ma jyotirgamai. Try to leave this dark place. Try to leave this land of struggle and suffering and mere survival and go for that potential, the potential of the soul, which is calling to you. So that poses a problem, however, because we find not just in spiritual life, but in any discipline, one requires some self-control. I was thinking a lot today, talking to a few other devotees about where one begins, because if you require discipline, as is suggested, for instance, in the Sri Upadeshamrita, to begin spiritual life, vacho vegam, the first words of Rupa Goswami, you have to control your tongue. I spoke about this last Sunday. Controlling the tongue, it's the first thing that's mentioned there, and also I quoted the verse, Atashi Krishna Amadi Nabhaved Grayam Indre, Seva Mukhihi Jivado Swayameva Spuratyada. Jiha Ado, where else would it begin except with the tongue? It says, yoga begins with the tongue, controlling the tongue. If you can control your speech and control what you eat, then you can. Then Krishna will want to come and see you if you can do that. And in fact, this verse, vacho vegam manasakrota vegam, jihva vegam udarapasta vegam, itan vegam yo vishaheta dhira saravam apimam pritivimsashishat, mentions that a person who can control the various urges of the senses is fit to be a spiritual master for the whole world. Because right now, the master of the world, the masters of the world, are the senses. They control everyone. And one may have a prestigious position as a great king or some kind of controller somewhere, but as Muchukunda Maharaj pointed out when he was praying to Krishna, although I am a great king, I am subjugated by my wives. When I come home, I'm entirely under their command. And there's a way in which one has to start somewhere in the process of self-discipline in order to make progress in spiritual life. So, what are the necessary steps? First of all, you have to have some motivation, don't you? Yes or yes?
Yes?
Yes, you do. You have to have some motivation. And interestingly enough, in my conversations today, I uncovered and remembered a paradigm mentioned by Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Of course, this is the help. I talked to Rasanath Prabhu, and he was mentioning different kinds of motivation, and it matched up almost completely with Bhaktivinoda Thakur's talk about motivation. What are the various stages of motivation that get you to take up self-discipline? And those various levels of motivation come first from fear. Fear that if I don't do this, it'll be worse for me later. That's one idea, that I have to do it. Can anybody relate to that?
Yes.
Good. Then there's another level above fear, which is prospect. What do I get out of this? And above prospect, you have duty. That I'm supposed to do this.
this is the right thing to do, therefore I'll do it. And above that is love. And they very much match up with the various modes of material nature. For instance, fear relates to the mode of ignorance, and prospect to the mode of passion. What's in it for me? What do I get back? And the mode of goodness is duty. Well, this is the right thing to do, therefore I'll do it. And then love is something, pure love is transcendental, beyond the three modes of material nature. So, in any way that one can begin the process, motivated by fear or prospect or duty or love, one can find some motivation to begin the process of discipline. And that word may sound a little scary sometimes, but it's a very essential concept. As I mentioned the other day, we have the circle of influence, and we have a circle beyond that of concern. And to perform the activities of that actually change our life, influence our life, which mostly have to do with controlling our own actions and preparing ourselves internally and externally so that we have more capacity, require some discipline to begin. So I've named the different kinds of motivation, and also in looking at this subject matter, I came to the conclusion, based on Shastra, that one also requires some outside influence. Because as Lord Chaitanya mentions to Sanatana Goswami in his teachings to him, Maya Mugda Jivaran Hai Swata Krishna Gyan, Jivare Kripa Koil Krishna Veda Puran. And that is that Srila Vyasadeva, specifically out of his mercy, brought forth the Vedic literatures, especially the Srimad Bhagavatam, as a means to intervene in the life of the jiva in the material world. And he says that the jiva doesn't automatically come out of maya and out of ignorance. Maya mugda jivaranahi swata. It's not automatic that any living entity comes out of the material world. And those who teach Krishna consciousness know that there are plenty of ways that little jiva makes excuses why he or she shouldn't take to Krishna consciousness right now. Can we please somebody offer seats to everybody, and if there's devotees sitting in the back, invite them to sit closer. Take care of our guests, please, as they come in. So it's not automatic, therefore we need outside influence, we also call, but we can keep concentrating here while they're doing that. Intervention, everyone say intervention.
Intervention.
Yeah, intervention. So the soul needs some intervention because the material world is a closed system. You get the same kind of knowledge in the material world, and the vibration of the material world keeps one moving within the closed walls of this universe. As Krishna even says, as we read in the ninth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, there's the words of the Vedas, and he says in the second chapter of the Gita, that are flowery. They offer some kind of material position, a nice residence in the heavenly planets, and for instance. There are many mantras that offer these kinds of situations, and all of them are the same because the living entity is still within the realm of the material world. Therefore,
Prabhupada gives this analogy that if you're in prison, you may have golden shackles, or you may have silver shackles or iron shackles. And somebody may show off, like, my shackles are gold. But they're shackles after all. Or you may even have in the prison, and this is actually a fact, you may have a very harsh environment. Sometimes people who have committed heavy crimes, violent crimes, they're put in lockdown, and they're only let out with shackles on their feet. And then there's a medium section of the prison where people are given a little more freedom. And then there are prisons that are almost like country clubs. That's where white-collar crime people go. They can go out and play basketball if they want to. They get extra kinds of concessions and food and things like that. And they consider themselves better off. And they are in some ways, but at the end of the day, they're still in prison. And the material world has various gradations, but it's all within the closed system of the material universe. Therefore, those who are within that system need to have some information that comes from outside the system so that they can become freed, liberated from that situation, and voluntarily take up the process of Krishna consciousness, which requires, as I keep repeating, some discipline, some self-control to begin the process and make some advancement. And as I've mentioned before, and this is the third point I'll make before we take some reflections, it's important, as Prabhupada mentions in one lecture repeatedly, to have knowledge and practice. And I've brought up the word in this assembly before, deliberation, or deliberate. You can say deliberate, everyone say deliberate. Deliberate. Or you can say deliberate. Deliberate. So in order to be deliberate in your actions, you first have to deliberate, which means that you have to look at the consequences of your actions. When one looks carefully, studies a course of action and has some clarity about what will be the outcome from the activities I'm performing now, deliberates on it, then one can be more deliberate in one's activities. So it's important for one who wants to take up this voluntary self-discipline of devotional service, take up the practice, to have some clarity, to deliberate on it, to hear about it, and to understand what the consequences are for making poor choices or making good choices. That's three things, but I'll say one more, and that is that one may also be confronted with one's own limiting beliefs. In other words, I limit myself by considering that I can only do so much. And one requires some good association to overcome these limiting beliefs in order to move forward in any kind of discipline. One has to have some confidence that I can succeed. That comes by good association and also by hearing. So I've named four items that help us get some traction in the practice of devotional service. And maybe you can help me and remember what they are. Well, if you have it, just take the microphone and mention them.
First one is motivation. Second one is influence. Is that right?
Yes. Outside influence.
Outside influence. Third is knowledge and practice. And fourth thing is that not limiting oneself.
I think I mentioned clarity as a category. And the last one?
Not limiting oneself by good association and hearing.
Yeah, removing self-limitations, self-limiting beliefs about what one can do and what one can't do. And now we'll take a few reflections. Anything that you heard so far that stuck in your mind? Yes.
Maharaj, in the starting of the lecture, you mentioned about Pradyumna Prabhu, that how he was around Srila Prabhupada, and it really, we are so lucky that we have Srila Prabhupada's disciple in the universe, and we can know what is the heart. And as you mentioned that he used to like, and Isopanishad verses when he chanted, he liked. So I was saying that.
Could you understand what he said? Could you? Did you hear what he said or understand it? I'll repeat it. It was hard to understand you. Earlier in the class, I had mentioned that I had been communicating with one of my godbrothers, Pradyumna Prabhu, who was Prabhupada's first Sanskrit editor. In fact, he was the first one in ISKCON to learn Sanskrit. He brought Prabhupada some verses from the Brahma Samhita that he had translated. He said, "Prabhupada, look, I translated these," because he was learning himself how to read and translate Sanskrit, and he was adept. So Prabhupada looked at him and he said, "Keep doing it." And he did. And he became very expert, a great scholar. Prabhupada called him Panditji. And your point about Pradyumna?
We can know the Prabhupada's heart by the devotees around that era who were there with him. And I was relating also that now also if someone asks like 40 years after, okay, what was there in the ISV? We can tell that there was Brahma Sanhita chanting every Saturday morning. There was...
Yeah, this is a parampara. That's what it means. It carries on, not just the knowledge or the book, but also there are details in between the lines, and there are moods, and there are many types of things that are important that you don't get from a Veda base. So, yeah, that's important. And also, in communicating with Pradyumna, and I was shocked because he wrote me right back, I mean, almost immediately, and very nice, such nice things he said also. And I was also feeling appreciative, and I learned this while I was writing my book, interviewing very senior devotees, and three of them passed away as I was not in the act of interviewing them, but around the same time. People, don't pick up his call. But pretty close to it. One of them I didn't get to because they told me he wasn't feeling well, and then a couple weeks later he was gone. So, I realized how much I was learning from the devotees who were actually there. You can actually ask people and say, you know, what was it like? What did Prabhupada do or say about this? And of course, you may get different answers from different people, but you can get a composite and a very good idea of what happened. So I was feeling motivated to talk to as many God brothers and God sisters who were there as possible to find out some of these nuances. Many of these things are recorded in books and things, but I found also that talking to them has a special flavor as well that you don't get just from reading the book. What other reflections? Yes.
Prabhuji, thank you so much for the wonderful class. It's very nice, especially chanting three chapters in the beginning and then getting into the class. One thing I was reflecting is on the point you made that reading Bhagavad Gita as much as you can. So when you read Bhagavad Gita, the influence of Maya will not be there or will be minimal. So that is one thing.
Yeah, it's a vibration that comes from beyond the material world. So in the Gita, Krishna mentions
prakrite kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvasha ahankara vimudatma kartaham iti manyate. The materialistically influenced soul thinks that I'm the doer. When Krishna says, in actuality, it's being carried out by material nature. And there's this ahankar, or this false sense, that I'm part of matter, and that I'm performing activities. And later on, Krishna says, tattva vittu mahabahu guna karma vibhagayo guna guneshu vartanta iti matva nasajite. That a person who is tattva vit, understands the truth, knows the difference between acting under the influence of material nature and acting according to higher direction that's coming from Krishna. He knows what the different outcomes are, and therefore he doesn't engage in activities that result in more bondage in the material world. And how did he become free? Because he became tattvavit. He became aware of what is truth. And this is an important aspect of getting some entrance into the process of devotional service. Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita recommends that we cultivate sattva, sattvagun, because sattvam yad brahma darshanam, from sattva, which means to be aware of what actually exists, sat, that which is real. And one also knows what is not real, what is temporary, as we hear from the verse in the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, nasato vidite bhavo, nabhavo vidite sata, ubayorapi dushtantas tvanayos tattvadarshibhi. That the seer of the truth understands the two different realms. One is that which exists, and the other is that which does not exist. Does not exist means that it is insubstantial, temporary. So coming to sattva-gun by various practices, practicing sattva in one's speech, in one's diet, creating a sattvic atmosphere, helps one come to this position where one can see the truth and therefore understand the consequences of one's activities and therefore be directed properly. What else? Yes, a text.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, Radha Kripa Prabhu is watching online.
So pardon me?
Radha Kripa Prabhu, he's watching online.
Where is he?
He's offering his dandavats. He's watching from home. He has
from
some
home,
family.
Okay.
Yeah, family
okay.
Members are sick. Yeah. Maharaj, and the text is from Vaikunth Nayak Prabhu.
Okay.
From India. He has a reflection and a question. The reflection is, I like the parallel you drew between Varna Dharma and Maslow's hierarchy of needs.
Between which dharma? Varnashram?
Varnashram
dharma, okay.
And then the question is, a question is on the Jiva Jivasya Jivanam Shloka. One Muslim preacher in India quotes this verse to prove that even Vedic scriptures say that animals are food for human beings. As this is a Shruti mantra, how can this argument be defeated?
Well, you can eat animals. In the Shruti, it's actually allowed. But you have to say to the animal before you eat them. First of all, there's regulations about how to do it. You can't do anything whimsically in this world without paying a price. That's the point. So Srimad Bhagavatam, 11th canto, points out, find the verse, 11th canto, that there's a general propensity for living entities to want to eat meat, want to have illicit sex, want to take intoxication, these particular things.
You'll know when you see it. 11th canto. Okay, 11:5-11. Loke vyavayami shamadya seva nitya hijantur nahitatra chodana vyavastatis teshu vivaha yagna sura grahar asu nivritta ishta. In this material world, conditioned soul is always inclined to sex, meeting, and intoxication. Therefore, religious scriptures never actually encourage such activities. Although the scriptural injunctions provide for sex through sacred marriage, for meat eating through sacrificial offerings, and for intoxication through the acceptance of ritual cups of wine, such ceremonies are meant for the ultimate purpose of renunciation. So yes, the Shrutis do allow for that, but that's not a license for you to go and do, eat whatever you want to eat. You have to follow the system, and if you're smart, and when you follow the system, and you have to utter the mantra into the ear of the goat. First of all, you can't kill cows. That's forbidden. And you say into the ear of the goat, I'm killing you now on this dark moon night, and in your next life, you'll kill me. And if you're not smart enough to figure out that that's not a good idea, then you have some propensity within you that is pushing you to do that. But at least it's done under Vedic regulation. And as you follow the Vedic regulation, then you can be saved from a severe reaction of just killing any animal that you want. Human life means there has to be some restriction or some responsibility. So yes, the jivo jivasya jivanam is there, but it doesn't say that human beings have the right to then wantonly kill anything and eat anything they want. They have to be careful. Otherwise, they get more karma. So mercifully, there are guidelines for human beings to do these kinds of things so they can gradually be elevated, a higher position. Yes, Gandharvika.
I was just pondering on the point where you said that motivation that comes out of fear. Usually the whole life goes like that because I don't want to be ridiculed by anybody. People should not think that I'm poor and things like that, because that conditioning is so much there within us. And even when we come into Krishna consciousness, the fear element is there, but it's just that you fear for a different thing. Like, I should not commit offenses, or people shouldn't think that I'm not meeting my goal, or something like that. But the real element of doing Krishna consciousness to please Krishna, that is like maybe 0.001%.
It's very rare. What percent? How much? No, how much is it?
not one. That's what I said.
Point what?
Not 0.001.
0.00?
Four zeros and one.
4, 0, and 1. Okay, it's in there though. And that's what counts. So the Shastra answers this question and says that whatever situation of life you're in, akama sarva kama va moksha kama udharadi tivrena bhakti yogena yajeta purusham param. That's akama, if you have no desire of the material world, sarva kama, you have all desires to enjoy the material world, moksha karma, you just want liberation, udharadi. Tivrena bhakti yogena, if you perform this, you bring all this to bhakti, then you'll come to the perfect stage. It's saying, come to Krishna. So Dhruva Maharaj is a good example. He really wanted something for himself, but because he came to Krishna, he got purified. And we know in the Brahma Samhita, yam krodha kama sahaja pranayadi piti vatsalya moha guru gaurava sevya bhava sanchintyatasya sadrishim tanama purete govindamari purushamtam aham bhajami. Yam krodha, out of anger, kama, lust, yam krodha kama, sahaja, natural friendly love, sahaja pranayati bhiti, out of fear. You know, all these ways in which you somehow approach Krishna and you become purified. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur mentions in one of his commentaries in the Brahma Samhita
that mixed devotional service means there's some element, as you've pointed out, of pure devotional service. What's the mixture? Pure with something else mixed in. But that one, that point zero zero, three zeros? Four zeros. Point zero 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 one means that is there. In fact, we read the story recently of the Avanti Brahmana. And when the Avanti Brahmana was growing up, he grew an empire. He was a Vaishya. He grew these huge industrial enterprises. He made so much money. But he was stingy. And he then lost the benedictions of all the demigods and all his family members and all his friends. Everyone abandoned him because he was a miser. And he lost everything. It all dried up. However, during his sojourn as a businessman, he had wished to have liberation. So he made some sincere prayers to God. And within those prayers, there was the 0.00001 element of sincere desire. And after he lost everything, that tiny sliver appeared in his heart, because it never goes away. Neha bikramanashosti pratyavaya navidite swalpam apyasya dharma su alpam, even if it's tiny, the tiniest of the tiny, Krishna says, that it'll save you from the most dangerous type of fear. It's eternally recorded and appreciated by Krishna. So he then became inspired within the heart, because in previously he had extended some tiny little portion of devotion to God in his heart. And that's what then turned him to a life of determination to go back home, back to God. Idam hyastaya paratmanishtam adyasitam purvatamar maharshibi aham tarishami durantaparam tamomukundangri nishevayaiva. He said, I shall cross over the insurmountable ocean of material existence by being firmly fixed in the service of the lotus feet of Krishna. This was approved by the previous acharyas who are fixed in firm devotion to the Lord Paramatma, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And all that came from just a little beginning, right? And he became such a great example that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu picked up that verse and said, this is our verse. We're going to keep this for our goal in life, to with determination, cross the material. So it starts from the tiniest of little entry into the arena of devotional service. So whatever motivation brings you there, you have to start somewhere. Yes, Shraddha? Oh my goodness. Okay.
So two things. I like the example that you gave of golden shackles. I mean, they are shackles in the end.
That's right.
You keep forgetting that.
Yeah, oftentimes the similar example is used about how you may drink the same kind of beverage but in different cups. And sometimes, you know, there are restaurants people make, you know, so what's the difference between an expensive restaurant and eating a picnic off a blanket in the field? The environment, you just change the environment a little bit. And this bondage, when it's packaged in a little bit different way, it looks like, oh, okay, that's kind of nice. But Krishna's point is, it's all bondage. And it's the same thing you're taking over and over again. Prahlad Maharaj said, punak punas charvita charvananam. You're chewing that which has already been chewed. You chew it and leave it, and then come back later and think, oh, let me try again. It's all recycled, the same thing. So you have to have something from a different stratum. Yes, Malini. You had another one. Okay.
I really like the point where you said about knowledge and practice leads to deliberation. And just this morning, I and Srivas were just thinking about taking up some activity and then we carefully consider.
As it, like you don't have enough, right?
And then we were just deliberately considering all the consequences of the actions that we do. And I felt so much of relief because instead of just blindly doing something, you sit down and you carefully consider. And I felt it's very important that every action, even in Krishna consciousness, deliberation is very important.
It really is. And being deliberating and then being deliberate in the way we make decisions and the way we speak to others too. I've been thinking about the same thing when I'm writing to people, especially. The words matter. Even one word can make a big difference in someone's life. If you're careless and you say it in the wrong way, it can really affect somebody. So human life really is about being deliberate and deliberating carefully. And the more that we do that, the more we can be precise in the way we move in the world. And the best thing to do is to center our activities around the process of pleasing Krishna. Making our decisions based on what's best for the service, to our service to Krishna. Yes. And Malini, you can pass yours back up here. Shraddha.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
I thank you for this opportunity to share this. I just wanted to deliberate about this tattvabit that you talked about. Sattvam yad brahma darshanam. So Sri Krishna says about sattvagunam. Mukta sango naham vadi dhityutsaha samanvitaha siddhya siddhyo nirvikaraha katha sattviga uchyate. In the 18th chapter, when he characterizes the various gunas, he talks about sattvaguna. This, he says very much the same thing that you have said. Mukta sango, one who is free. Naham vadi, that I am not the doer. Dhrityutsaha samanvitaha, that is, one is with infused with confidence and motivated. Dhiti utsaham is motivation. Saha samanvitaha, siddhi asiddhi, whether successful, not successful, failure or success, he's not affected by all that because he's constantly fixed on me. Siddhi asiddhi, nirvikaraha, he doesn't get, he doesn't change, he's one with me, sattvika gunam. So, siddhi asiddhyo nirvikaraha, karta sattvika uchyate. So that is the definition for a...
What's the verse number?
18th chapter, Moksha Sanyasa Yogam. 18th chapter, 64th shloka.
1864, let's have a look at it. Oops.
A little after that. Mukta Sango Naham Vadi.
Here, look it up by the verse. It's not in the shloka book.
I might have
here.
Mistaken. Yeah, I can find it out.
He'll get it. 26.
It starts with Mukta Sango.
At 26.
Had
the six.
Forgive
right.
me.
Okay, I'll say, please repeat. Mukta Sango Naham Badi.
Mukta Sango Naham Badi.
Dhrityusaha Samanvitaha.
Siddhya Siddhyor Nirvikara.
Karta sattvika uchite. The translation is, one who performs his duty without association with the modes of material nature, without false ego, with great determination and enthusiasm, and without wavering in success or failure, is said to be a worker in the mode of goodness. Purport. A person in Krishna consciousness is always transcendental to the material modes of nature. He has no expectations for the result of the work entrusted to him, because he is above false ego and pride. Still, he is always enthusiastic till the completion of such work. He does not worry about the distress undertaken. He is always enthusiastic. He does not care for success or failure. He is equal in both distress and happiness. Such a worker is situated in the mode of goodness. Yes, thank you for revisiting that point about sattva gun, throughout the Gita, Krishna gives the various symptoms of workers in sattva-gun, determination, taste, and also the importance of cultivating that higher mode of material nature. From there, sattvam yad brahmadarshanam. One can see the difference between that which is real and that which is not real. And that helps a lot. Because if we're blinded to what is in our self-interest and what actually the consequences are of certain activities are. For instance, he mentions in the mode of passion, it leads to unlimited desires and longings if we engage in it. And from the mode of goodness, one gets clarity, one gets liberated from the influence of the modes of material nature. Yes.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. So the two things you mentioned, one was motivation and external influence. And I was just thinking that how they go together. Like for example, Dhruva Maharaj, he had motivation to do something extraordinary. But until he had the external influence coming from Narad Muni, as his guru who gave him the Diksha Mantra of Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, he wouldn't have been successful because that is the mantra which took him through the 6 months into the highest platform. So, yeah. I mean, we have Guru Tattva available, but then one should have the motivation to feel that that person needs a shelter. So that is...
Yes, and if you want a guru like Narada Muni, you better have the determination of Dhruva Maharaj.
Yes.
That's a fact. This is the determination of a disciple, of a seeker, informs Krishna. Krishna is already informed, as we heard. Vedaham samatitani vartamanani charjuna bhavishyami ca bhutani mam tu vena na kashchana. He said, I know everyone, I know everything. And he knows the determination of a particular soul, the motivation within the heart. Therefore, he provides the outside influence in the form of guru. Brahmanda brahmate kon bhagyavan jeev guru krishna prasadi pai bhakti lata beej. By the mercy of Krishna, one gets guru, and by the mercy of guru, one gets Krishna. So that's a nice point to remember. In fact, in any discipline, one needs to have some kind of person who is giving that outside influence. You see, in sports, people have coaches, right? They don't coach themselves because they need somebody to actually guide them. And Vidura, who is a pure devotee in his own right, Prabhupada points out, needed the help of Maitreya because he said the science of pure devotional service is such a refined science. You need that outside influence to help you. Thank you. So, yes.
If Hansapriya Mataji is watching you online.
Oh, good.
She offers you her dandavats. She says that she found the point motivation out of fear is very deep. And she also noticed that it takes away the sweetness and beauty of service if you're doing it out of fear, I guess.
But you'll still be doing service nonetheless.
Along the same lines, I was thinking about that Muslim preacher that Vaikuntha was saying that he's been quoting the Shruti Mantra, so he'll get some benefit from that. But
yeah.
In the wrong way.
Yeah. Yes, Malini.
Ruchi, when you were just saying about this four points, I was just relating it to the goals for ISV. I was just thinking initially we had a little bit of motivation that we can do it, but then you came in as an outside influence saying that we can do 10% more, and then we deliberately considered what we can do it, and we thought maybe we can't, but then you showed us that how we shouldn't limit ourselves just to the 10%. So I was just thinking how it all goes well with the goals that we set.
Yeah, I can remember how year after year we'd get together to discuss the next year's goals. We've been doing this for a while. And
In fact, I remember when we first started the monthly Sankirtan festival, and then I got a letter. I'm probably still on my hard drive because I have 28,000 unread emails. But I remember distinctly there was some concern that we were pushing too hard, it was too big. And I wrote a piece about thinking big and how important it was. And then we had our biggest monthly Sankirtan festival. It was just 2 days out of the month. And I can remember also times when we were sitting around thinking about how to set the next goals, and seemingly they seemed impossible. I can remember one incident when Damodar Vamsidhari was sort of hovering over our group where we were discussing the goals, and it was some very large goal for collecting for us at the time. And we were kind of nervous, can we do it, should we pin ourselves to this goal? And Damodar Vamsidhari said, oh, no problem, you'll make that. And immediately we all went, yeah, we can do it. There was an outside influence. He came in, he had confidence. He just said, yeah, you can do it. And then we all had confidence too. So you get this from good association. You can have this outside influence too. And that's why, as you mentioned, the Guru Tattva is there. You have to take that kind of help constantly throughout. This is the means through which we keep moving forward. We align ourselves from those who are already on a higher platform, who can put outside influence into our lives. When we landed in Denver, Colorado recently, that is Nirkula and myself, and Tushta Krishna, the great sadhu, saint who's the temple president there in Denver, picked us up at the airport. And Nirkula was just asking him how his father was doing, because his mother is a little ill right now and things like that. And he was talking about different people who were helping in the family and stuff. And he just uttered these words as we were walking out the door to get in his car, that no man is an island. And that everyone requires, especially for advancing in devotional service, a complete support system on all sides. One should align oneself properly and have a complete support system so that one can make this life successful and not leave any gaps, not leave it to chance, but take all help from outside influences that are benevolent and who have the power to help us to move forward. It's very important. Yes.
This is from across the borders, Canada. Hare Krishna Prabhu, please accept our humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Really like the point about causes of motivation being related to modes of material nature. We can use that to motivate us intelligently to move forward in devotional life. We also better understood deliberate and deliberation. Thank you very much to you and to the ISV broadcast team for connecting us all. Your servants, Anukul Seva Das and Jishnu.
Oh, Anukul Seva and Jishnu too. Jai, thank you very much. Great to hear from you. Yes, Ashok.
Prabhuji, thank you for taking the questions. So while chanting 9:17 in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna is saying here, I am also the Rig, Sama and Yajur Veda. But here it is not mentioned Atharvana Veda. Can you explain?
Rig Sama.
He mentions only Rig Sama and Yajur Veda, but he does not talk about Atharvana Veda.
Atharva Veda. Atharva Veda. So the Rig Veda really is, there are prayers, really. The Rig Veda is a series of prayers that welcome the demigods to come into a sacrifice. All these various Shrutis mantras are really for performing yajna. So the Rig Veda is compared like the butler. You know,
a butler is. When you go to a house of a rich man, the butler answers the door, invites you in, and sits you down before the master of the house comes out. So the Rig Veda mantras are like the butler. And the Yajurveda is like a magic trick. The magician comes out and performs magic, because these mantras from the Yajurveda, they transform the various kinds of material elements that are used in the sacrifice into transcendental transcendental items. So, for instance, there's in any sacrifice you'll see the pot, Shri pot, and that has to be turned into a worshipable item. It's just an ordinary pot. But through these mantras from the Yajurveda, these various material elements then become transformed. And how is it that they're transformed? Because there are various kinds of speech, as I've mentioned before, that create reality. For instance, when a judge, when you come before the judge and the judge declares that you're to be awarded $1 million, then that's real. You actually are awarded $1 million, right? If a guy in the corner tells you that, you'll just say, thanks, buddy, and walk away. So similarly, the mantras in the Yajurveda give this have this transformational quality. Then the Samaveda is entertainment for the demigods. And the Atharva Veda is meant to, or mantras to take away any obstacles that are there. Now, I haven't answered your question exactly yet, but there are various divisions of the Vedas. Originally, they're really a series of mantras, sometimes described as a jungle of sounds. Very hard to discern which goes where and what's for what for which purpose. Vyasadeva, the word Vyas actually means he's the editor. He doesn't write the Vedas. The Vedas are eternal, but he organizes them. It's described in the Tattvasandarbha that just like the king has a whole box full of invaluable jewels, and then someone comes in and sorts them out. The rubies go here, the diamonds go there, they're put in different categories. So those categories are looked at very in different ways and in different times. They're organized so they can be propagated and spread further ways. So I'd have to look at it to see if there's anything particularly in commentaries of Baladeva or Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur about why those three are mentioned and not the others. But the idea is that it's a fluid situation. Okay. Everyone's here starting the new year, I think. Or some are coming, because there's a feeling at the beginning of the year to start off anew, make new determination. Does anybody have that going on in their life right now? Starting over? New vows and such? One person. So my main point here is that we have to find those activities that are particularly useful to us and focus our mind there, because there's every possibility of being distracted, and to determine what are those activities in our life that help us move forward to the goal and keep those as the main focus and the basis of our life produces a feeling of satisfaction that we're actually moving forward. Otherwise, we can be caught in a many-branched situation where the mind has all kinds of activities to perform that are not really useful, that maybe some of them even entangling. So, we'll take Krishna's advice from the Bhagavad Gita, Vyavasayatmika Bhudir Ekeha Kurunandana Bahushaka Hyanantascha Bhudayo Vyavasayinam. That be very deliberate in organizing your life around thinking of Krishna and performing devotional practices. Otherwise, you can become caught up in unlimited other activities that are simply distracting. Any last reflections? Yes.
I don't remember the verse exactly, but I think in that same chapter, Lord Krishna is also saying this. Bahunam Sakha, what he's mentioning is actually coming from the flowery language of the Vedas, because where he's referring to these three or four Vedas, where you say, if you want this, then do this, if you want this, then do that. So, you know, all those things are there. So that's the context. That's what Krishna is saying. Those who are desirous of so many millions of things, their intelligence becomes many branched instead of focusing on the Supreme.
Yeah, that's right. Please, the verse, Mukharvin, that he referred to. It's in the Gita, not in the Shloka book here. Second chapter. This is Bhagavad Gita 2:42 and 2:43.
Yeah.
Krishna says, men of small knowledge are very much attached to the flowery words of the Vedas, which recommend various fruitive activities for elevation to heavenly planets, result in good birth, power, and so forth. Being desirous of sense gratification and opulent life, they say there is nothing more than this. And then the verse comes in 2:44, Bhogaishvarya prasaktanam taya prahita chetasam vyavasayatmika buddhi samadhauna vidhiyate. In the minds of those who are too attached to sense enjoyment and material opulence and who are bewildered by such things, the resolute determination for devotional service to the Supreme Lord does not take place. And Prabhupada says this in his purport. Samadhi means fixed mind. The Vedic dictionary, the Nirukti, says, Samyag adhiyate smin, atma tattva yatatmyam. When the mind is fixed for understanding the self, it is said to be in samadhi. Samadhi is never possible for persons interested in material sense enjoyments and bewildered by such temporary things. They are more or less condemned by the process of material energy. This is samadhi means the mind is fixed for understanding the self. And without that orientation in life, then Prabhupada mentions that we're condemned by the process of material nature. It means you're easily dragged away. So having that orientation is vital. And Bhoga Aishvarya, go back to the verse. We'll look at the word for word. Bhoga means to material enjoyment, and Aishvarya means opulence. Prasaktanam, for those who are attached to, by such things, aprahita chetasam, and they become bewildered in mind. Vyavasaya atmika, fixed in determination, buddhi, devotional service to the Lord, samadhau, in the controlled mind, never.
vidyate does take place. So, but thinking that there's having some optimism for finding material enjoyment and having opulence in the material world, it cancels out one's determination for self-realization. The two don't go well together. Polar opposites. Yes, what else? Yes.
Maharaj, I was just looking at the translation and it says buddhi as devotional service to the Lord. Generally, buddhi means intelligence. So I was just wondering, you know, maybe some context is involved there.
Yes, because it's called buddhi yoga. And buddhi yoga means that Krishna is there directing us from within the heart. And when one focuses one's intentions on serving Krishna, then as Krishna says in the 10th chapter of the Gita, Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam pritipurvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayanti te. He gives the intelligence by which one can come to him, to those who are connected through the process of what is called buddhi yoga. They're getting direction from the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In fact, everyone's getting direction from Krishna within the heart. But because my desires are turned towards material nature, he's overseeing and permitting me to enjoy in the material world. But when one turns one's attention back to Krishna, then Krishna gives direct instruction how to come to him. So one point I just read recently in the 11th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam is that if Krishna gives so much facility to the living, for the living entity to forget him and to try to enjoy an illusory material world, imagine how much facility he'll give to somebody who turns his attention. Don't think that he won't give you full facility. In fact, if you have Babaji's coming out. They're chanting 64 rounds today back there. It's mentioned if you have just a little bit of tinge of desire for enjoyment in the material world, then by the process of material nature, you'll be... Go get a can of WD-40 and fix that. Since you were the last one out. You know what WD-40 is? Okay, find out. Ask Ramananda Sakha. Go ask him, wherever he is. Somebody teach her about WD-40. It takes away the squeak. I'm sorry? Yeah. I want to finish my point, though, that even if you have the slightest desire for self-realization, this goes for the motivation in any realm. Krishna's there within the heart, and he's helping us to have facility. If there's so much facility for material enjoyment, obviously he'll give us even more for advancing in spiritual life. So we should be motivated by that and know that whatever the tiniest motivation we may have for devotional service, we should fan that spark and not think that, oh, it's not enough, or I'm too fallen, so therefore I'll just take shelter of Maya. No, take shelter of Krishna's promise in the Bhagavad Gita that he'll protect you in all circumstances. And if you try, even in the minutest way, to turn towards Krishna, which is very helpful when you're overwhelmed by material nature, because it seems like I'll never get out of this, and I don't have the power to do anything. Take shelter of even the tiniest inspiration that you have, because that will take you through. And why? Because Krishna's there within the heart and is assisting you, assisting every living entity. Yes. We have Priya Kishori and then Shraddha, you have something from the internet.
So just to follow up on your answer to Prabhu's question, where you were saying that when Krishna, that even though just for our material life, he's allowing us so much facility, but for our spiritual life, he will give us even more. There's a verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam that also says, Yasyaham anugrinami harishyetad dhanam shanai, that when the Lord wants to show his supreme mercy to his devotee, he takes everything away. So how should we think of those two in parallel lines?
Well, everything is different for various people. For instance, when Sudama Brahman went to Krishna because his wife urged him, he's your friend from school, so you should go see him. They were so poor that Sudama's ribs were showing, and they didn't even have enough food in the house for them to take a little something to offer to Krishna. They had to beg it from the neighbors. And after meeting Krishna, Sudama was coming home and he was thinking, Krishna didn't give me anything, but I didn't go there to ask him for anything. I didn't want anything. I'm glad he didn't notice that. And when he came home, his home was transformed into an opulent heavenly planet, practically. And Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that Krishna gave him everything because Sudama was actually attached to being austere. And so for him, he gave him all this opulence. For others, he may take it away. Fact is that Krishna is, as mentioned by Sridhar Swami, the great Bhagavatam commentator on the verse Tat Te Anukampam Susamikshamano, is fully aware of the inner workings of every living entity and knows exactly how to adjust the situation in order to make that person more attached to himself. And so for different people, he may arrange in different ways the giving of wealth, the taking away, and so forth. You can say in the mic.
Like the Avantika Brahman, for him, he did the other way. He actually took away his wealth. So
yeah, he was, took away, and he was actually practically harassed by so many different people. Shraddha, you have one from the text? Yes, please go ahead.
There's this couple from Fremont. They recently took a Srimad Bhagavatam and they started coming to the temple. And today they are actually watching you online.
Hare Krishna.
So they're saying, today's session was wonderful and very informative. I'm so happy for that. And then they really like the classes and the way you explain things, saying it's really very awesome. And today's session is just too good.
Oh, thank you very much.
That's Paramita and Indranil Chakravarti. Then Radha Kripa Prabhu, he's back to Vaikunth Nayak Prabhu's comments on a Muslim preacher picking up that random shloka. So he's saying that the Muslim preacher picks random shlokas and interprets them to suit his ideology to prove the supremacy of one philosophy over other. It's really very important for a sincere seeker of truth to refer to the authorized scripture which can direct on to the right path. And for that we are indebted to Srila Prabhupada, who has provided us such a wonderful treasure which is authorized and puts one in the right direction. Jai Prabhupada. Listening from realized soul is utmost important. Thanks Guru Maharaj for keeping us alive in Krishna consciousness.
Yeah, one has to see the continuum of purpose throughout the Vedic scriptures, from the Shruti and the Smriti, the Pancharatra. All of these have an ultimate purpose. And if, for instance, you take one segment of a tree, you may analyze it and say, oh, tree's like this or like that. But you have to look at the entire tree and its ultimate purpose. So the Vedas are compared to one unit. They are one unit. They're compared to a tree, which has many different branches. However, the ultimate purpose of the tree is to produce a fruit. The fruit of the tree is there, declared in the Srimad Bhagavatam,
Nigama Kalpataror Galitam Palam Shukamukaram Rita Dravasam Yutam. There's an ultimate purpose of all the Vedas. And if Krishna mentions this in the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, verse please, that if you know the purpose of the Vedas, then you can take full advantage of them. Just in the same way, he gives this example. Well, that's not it, is it? Yes. All purposes served by a small well can at once be served by a great reservoir of water. Similarly, all the purposes of the Vedas can be served to one who knows the purpose behind them. That is verse number 245. So, nice point, Radhakripa Prabhu. And what else? Not now, we're talking. Thank you.
Before I go to the next one, I was just going to comment that Mukharvinda's searching powers are faster than Google's, the way he's the way he's dishing out verses from there.
We could advertise him, faster than Google. We'll put him up.
So the next one is from Kameshwari Mataji.
Oh, good.
Dhanvat Pranams, all glories to Srila Prabhupada. Thank you for the wonderful class. I have a question. You mentioned that we get confidence by association with devotees. Now, despite of association with devotees, if sometimes we don't feel confident, then what is that one thing that one is missing? And what is the process to remove negativity and realize confidence in spiritual practice?
What does the word confidence mean?
As a noun, it means, it's a noun, the feeling or belief that one can rely on someone or something, firm trust, the state of feeling certain about the truth of something, a feeling of self-assurance arising from one's appreciation of one's own abilities or qualities. And confidence is also sometimes a secret or a private matter.
Well, one develops confidence in devotional service by having one's own experience or realization. For instance, in the Gita, Krishna says that Vishaya vinivartante niraharasa dehina rasavarjam rasopyasya param drishva nivartate, that you may be engaged in devotional service and restraining the senses from their objects, but when you get a higher taste, then you naturally give up the lower taste. It's not a matter of restraint anymore. And by seeing it for yourself, by having the experience for yourself, then you're the most confident because it's your own experience. And Jiva Goswami mentions in his Sandarbha that realization, personal realization, is the ultimate evidence. You can corroborate with all the scriptures and things, but you have actually see it for yourself. So it's important to go back to your basics and really do good rounds and read the Bhagavad Gita and come back to that state that brought you to Krishna consciousness in the first place. Revisit that intelligence that you got from Krishna within the heart, saying this is the right place to be, and don't fade away. Oftentimes, people don't just dramatically drop their spiritual practices and run off into Maya, but they fade away, and you have to avoid that fade by keeping up the basics and being a neophyte each day. Start over and do the basic things that actually keep you completely and absolutely connected to Krishna, because there's a real taste in that. You have to feel it for yourself. If you read Bhagavad Gita, you'll feel for yourself that Krishna is speaking to you directly. If you chant Hare Krishna and you concentrate and you pray when you chant, you'll feel differently than if you don't do it. And when you start noticing the difference, you start getting confidence in the practice. So you have to get that kind of confidence. So basic daily practice is very important to get your own realization. One more, okay.
This is Siddhi Prabhu.
Oh, good.
And he's saying that I like the point that even if there is 00001, it is still there.
That's the Swalpam Apyasya, Su-alpam. What else? Su-alpam. Krishna goes to the trouble of not just saying alpam, but he says Su-alpam. It means very, very little. If it's there, it's the rarest thing in the world. And it's more important than all the other things that are mixed in. And it will prevail. And so wherever there's a spark, fan it, take advantage of it, and make it grow. And it will grow. Gaura Premanande. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us here at ISV on a Wednesday night for spiritual discussion. And for all of you who tuned in through the internet, thank you very much. We feel your presence for sure. Everyone, please greet everyone online. They can't hear you. You got to be a little louder. Yeah, thank you very much. So please keep the vibration going. Take shelter of the holy names of the Bhagavad Gita, the Srimad Bhagavatam, and of all the outside influence you can get from association with devotees. And you'll ply smoothly across this dangerous ocean of the material world and go back home, back to Godhead. And do not fade away. Don't fade away. Make sure that you renew yourself. And it's even in physical exercise, there's such a thing as muscle memory. Even if you lose your muscle mass because of some disease, when you come back, the muscle memory is there. So if you practice very sincerely a devotional service, and somehow or other you find yourself fading away, you just need to come back, make a sincere comeback, and it'll all come back by Krishna's mercy. Thank you very much.
Nacharyar Marman, Nacharyar Marman, Nacharyar Marman, Nacharyar Marman, hey! Nacharyar Marman, Nacharyar Marman, Nacharyar Marman, Nacharyar Marman.